As we move into meditation, please get comfortable in your seats. Maybe put your feet flat on the floor, your hands open to God. Close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Release slowly. Another deep breath. Release deeply. Move down and focus on your heart. You are the heart. You are the hands. You are the voice of spirit on earth. Your gentleness, your patience, your accepting nature, your encouragement, your compassion, you make a difference in other people's lives. Shoulders to lean on, arms to comfort, words to soothe, smiles to connect. Who you are and all you do is a blessing to the world. Take that into your being. Who you are and all you do is a blessing to the world. Who you are and all you do is a blessing to this church, too. A church isn't brick and mortar, carpet, or the curtains. It's you. It's all of us. Sharing our loving kindness and gifts with each other. Take that into your heart and into your being. You are, and all you do, a blessing to this church. Spirit is calling us each to stretch, to grow, to connect with each other in new ways, to make a difference. The question is, how can we each be a blessing in someone's life today? How can we each be a blessing to the church? By being here today, you have blessed each other. By your sharing, you're connecting. That's spirit. Spirit is shining through each and every one of you. Each and every one of us. Take a deep breath in. Think thoughts of gratefulness. Thank you, Mother, Father, God, Sweet Spirit, for your presence in us always. And so it is. Namaste.
Fellas, would it be best if I just don't say anything? Use me, God. Show me how to take who I am, who I want to be, and what I can do, and use it for a purpose greater than myself. Use me, God. Show me how to take who I am, who I want to be, and what I can do, and use it for a purpose greater than myself. Those words, of course, came from Dr. Martin Luther King. That was his prayer. That is our prayer. We are all called to serve, to love, to be. We are all blessed with spiritual gifts. Some are expressed through our hands, some through our minds, some through our hearts. My prayer today for each of us is that we find and live a perfect connection, a perfection connection, we'll call it, between our gifts and the needs of others. Use me, God. Now, our songs today, Swing Wide the Doors, The Time is Right, Do All You Can, It's in Every One of Us, May We Be Who We Were Created to Be, I Work for God. Is there a common theme there? Mm-hmm. Of course. They're all about gifts. They're all about calling. So let's start right off with this. What is a calling? We hear this word all the time. It's a big, important thing that's reserved for the saints and heroes. Actually, it is, because we are the saints and heroes. It's a big, important thing. It's reserved for you and for me. It's in every one of us, just like the song said. And it's up to us to open our eyes and see that, and then to move with it, and then to move with it. So, yeah, there's a common theme, a calling. What is a calling? Well, here's a kind of a cool illustration of it. This is a story. I'll leave it to you to decide whether it actually happened. It's a legend about St. Francis. It's the dead of winter. St. Francis is talking to a tree in the forest. All right? Now picture this. There's snow everywhere. There are no leaves on the tree. It's cold. The wind is blowing. And St. Francis is out there in the forest talking to a tree. And he says to the tree, speak to me of God, and the tree comes alive. It bursts into bloom. Fruit, leaves, the fullness, the sap, there it is. It just comes alive just like that. This is what God is. This is what God is for us. God comes alive in each of us. When God calls us, speak to me of God, we come alive. It can take a lot of different forms now. It can be something really, you know, dramatic and legendary, like St. Francis and the tree. It might be instantaneous like that. It might take years. Now, here's something I've always wondered about. When did Jesus actually recognize his calling? When did he know that he had something special to do? Was it when he was 30 years old and he was baptized by John the Baptist and he started his ministry? Or was it when he was 12 years old and he sat with the wise elders of the temple and talked philosophy with them? Or was it when he was a newborn baby in the manger? Or was it even before that? To infinity, to the very beginning of time and before. Did he know all along? Did he see his destiny? I kind of like the idea that he knew all along. Now, he had total clarity. Jesus had total clarity in his life. And yet, even he faced temptation. Even he experienced doubt. Even he experienced fear. See, I think he saw the whole picture and he answered the call anyway. Let me say that again. He saw the whole picture and he answered the call anyway. Now, most of us don't have that level of clarity in our lives. I don't know about you, but most of us live our lives, or at least part of our lives, in a kind of spiritual slumber. So when we speak of a calling, maybe another way to express it would be to say that it's an awakening. Just like that tree came awake when St. Francis asked it to speak to him of God. It might happen in a moment, like that tree blooming, or it might be a slow, gradual process, because that's how plants and trees and people usually grow. However it goes, you know what? It's God saying, hey, wake up. Wake up. I have something for you. I have something for you to do. I have something for you to be. Wake up. It could be as extreme as Mother Teresa going to India, or a soldier doing something above and beyond. They heard the invitation, they answered the call. It could be something as simple, I will say seemingly simple, as a kind word to somebody who looks like they might need one. Imagine you're next door here getting your oil changed and you're in the waiting room and you offer a kind word, a connection to someone who maybe is hurting a little bit. You offer some comfort, you listen, and that person goes home later and decides, hey, maybe I can keep living after all. Maybe my life is worth something after all. Because, you know, Hebrews 13:2 says, sometimes we entertain angels unaware. Sometimes we entertain angels unaware. Sometimes we help people and we mean more to people than we know. It radiates outward, ripples outward to unknown realms. When you listen to that person, you answered the invitation. You answered the call. How about serving on one of our ministry teams? We have a lot of energy and attention around that right now. The celebration team, the chaplains, facilities and decor, the greeters and the ushers, the media, the board of directors, the music team, maybe even a couple of new teams that haven't even formed yet. The Earth Care team, maybe one that nobody has even thought of, but it's in your heart, you're hearing, you're listening to the invitation that says, hey, this is something that I could do. This is God giving me an invitation to rise up higher and to bring something. You know what? You just answered the call. Paula and I have a neighbor. His name is George Wilcox. He goes to the Humane Society once a week and walks the dogs. He answered the invitation. Hank and Honey, who are not here today, just adopted a dog. I'm sure that was a call. That was an invitation from God to rise up higher. They heard the invitation. They answered the call. So it's all good. It's all God. It's all awakening. It's all a calling. It's all a gift. It's your calling. It's your gift. You ready? Right now? Today? Got it all figured out? Yeah? Okay. I can think of two things that might muddy the waters just a little bit on that. One is the idea of a spiritual slumber. Sometimes we're just not truly awake, just not listening. The other is resistance, aka who, me? God, are you kidding? Who, me? No, of course you're going to resist. Of course you're going to resist. Put those two things together. Well, here's a great example of both of them happening at the same time. Lord of the Rings, third movie, third book also. Who's seen that movie, The Return of the King? Okay. There are two kingdoms side by side, Gondor and Rohan. They're both being threatened by the great evil, the darkness, Sauron. All right. Now, Gondor and Rohan are, they ain't exactly friends, but they ain't exactly enemies. Okay? They coexist. And they do have an agreement between them that if it comes to the final push, the back is against the wall, they will call on each other for aid. And they do this in the form of these beacons, which are basically these big, gigantic torches that are up on top of the mountains. Okay? Do you remember this? Can you see it in your mind? Now, the king of Rohan, Theoden is his name, has been in a spell for a long time. He was put under a spell by Saruman, I think. Okay. He hasn't been himself. He has not been himself, but he has just recently awakened from that because Gandalf showed up and brought him out of the spell. Well, hey, it's the Lord of the Rings. Of course there's going to be incantations and spells. And, you know, it could happen. He has just recently come back to himself. He's almost like, you know, he's just waking up like, oh. Okay. And as this is happening, Aragorn and some of the others burst into the room and they say, the beacons are lit, the beacons are lit, Gondor calls for aid. Okay, now, everybody who's standing around Theoden is going,
well?
And at least in the movie version, there's silence for, it's 10 seconds. And the actor, I have to say, does an incredible job. What you see in his face is, he runs through all the permutations of this thing. We don't really like Gondor that much, or in the first place, or trust them. And if we do this, we're going to lose half our army. If we don't do it, we'll probably lose everything. And then he rises past that. And what he really hears is, this call for help was a calling for me to rise above all of that, to move into my highest point, my highest consciousness. And he says, and Rohan will answer. Great moment. Great moment. He awakened. He overcame his resistance. Most of us don't experience calling in such a dramatic way. It's usually something simpler. Adopt a dog. Become a minister.
Take the dog,
she said. Okay. You might still be thinking, well, hey, it's still not really that easy because you're talking about gifts and calling. Do I have spiritual gifts? What is my calling? How am I supposed to know that? How do I discern my gifts? How do I even know what my calling is? I can't answer that. God can answer that, and you can answer that. So I'll just give you 7 words and a prayer. And if you take them into your life, maybe it will help you move forward in your understanding. All right? The 7 words. No, they're not the 7 words you can't say on television. Prayer. Presence. Service. Study. witness, share, and love. Each word, I'll say it, take it into your heart. Prayer. Presence. Service. Study. Witness. Share. And love. There was a woman named May Roland. She was the leader of Silent Unity for decades. If you don't know what Silent Unity is and you're new, ask me afterwards. Ask one of our guest ministers, ask one of our chaplains. It's a phenomenal story. It's a phenomenal thing. Take this prayer into your heart quietly. Share it, affirm it, know it to be true for everyone you meet, for people you haven't met, for yourself. This is the Child of Light prayer from May Roland. Child of Light, I bless you. I think of you. I pray for you. Not in terms of what I think you need or what I think you should do or be or express. I lift up my thoughts about you. I see you as you truly are, a holy child of light. I see you guided and directed by an inward spirit that leads you unerringly onto paths that are just right for you. I see you strong and whole. I see you blessed and prospered. I see you courageous and confident. I see you capable and successful. I see you free from all limitations or bondage of any kind. I see you as the spiritually perfect being that you truly are. Child of Light, I bless you. Say that with me, please.
Child of Light, I bless you.
And again. Child of Light,
I bless you.
One more time.
Child of Light, I bless you.
You see, the place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. That's a quote to Frederick Buechner, author, theologian. The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. Today, I affirm and declare for all of us that each of us is finding and living a perfect connection between our gifts and the needs of others. And I know that in the fullness of our gifts and callings, we are all just like that tree in winter, bursting into bloom, coming alive in God. And I know this. I know that I can lean on you. And you, sometimes in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, before it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on.
Swallow your pride. If I have things you need to borrow for, no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show.
You just call on me, brother, when you need a hand.
We all need somebody to lean on.
I just might have a problem that you understand.
We all need somebody to lean on.
Lean on me when you're not.
Hold up your hands with me. Hold up your hands with me. The fourth chapter of Peter in the New Testament says this: serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the very strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things. And so let us know this together. We are awakening here to our spiritual magnificence. The world calls, and we will answer. And so it is.
Amen. Amen.